Hi, eighth graders. We're continuing our read of The Greatest Treasure Hunt in History. And we're going to begin at the bottom of page 123. On November 18th, Stout met Hancock in Auction, still under bombardment by German artillery, to resume their search for treasures missing from the city's major art museum. The battle for Auction had been waged from the air, in the streets, and from room to room. Every building had some battle scar. While the facade of the Sermont Museum building had suffered minor damage, the interior spaces had been trashed. Shattered glass and debris littered the floors. Soldiers, or perhaps displaced persons, had rifled through the museum records. The place was a wreck. Sifting through the records, looking for clues, was painstaking work. Even for a sculptor and artist like Hancock, who measured progress over months and years. Too little light and too much dust forced him to use his flashlight, but reading documents through the floating silvery particles illuminated by the beam strained his eyes. He coughed constantly. Then came a breakthrough. Hancock found a list of schools and courthouses where the Sumat's less valuable holdings had been stored for safety. Further digging led to a copy of the official museum catalog. A note on the cover explained that objects marked in red had been moved a second time for safety to Sagan, a town about 110 miles east of Auction. Hancock quickly unfolded his map while pondering a new problem. Somewhere in the town of Sagan, 104 paintings and 48 pieces of sculpture, and who knew what else, belonging to the Sermont Museum in Auction lay in hiding. But where? And when would U.S. troops force a German retreat sufficient to allow the monument's men to enter Sagan? Excuse me. Hancock felt certain about one thing. If the ferocity of the battle for Auction was indicative of the fight ahead, any art repository in Sagan might not survive, even if they could find it. But at last, their detective work had paid a dividend. The monument's men had a name, a target, Sagan, Germany. Near Auction, Germany, early December 1944. Captain Walter Hutchhausen, one of two new additions to the monument's men, reported for duty to 9th Army in early December. Army bureaucracy was only partly to blame for the 6-month delay in getting him into service. In mid-June 1944, just days after arriving in London, Hutchhausen was seriously injured during a V-1 rocket attack, German retaliation for the successful D-Day landings at Normandy. Even while recuperating, he worked each day preparing a glossary of commonly used German terms for English-speaking soldiers. So on page 125, we have a picture of him. So he reported for duty, and then he was injured in a bombing that occurred when the Germans retaliated for the D-Day invasion. Having studied in pre-war Germany, Hutchhausen knew the country and the language, both valuable attributes for the challenges ahead. His experience as an architect was an essential skill to aid in the salvation of damaged but repairable buildings, especially as the amount of enemy territory under Allied control increased. The monuments men who had met with him, Rohrmer over dinner in Paris, Stout during a field inspection, and Hancock when First Army turned over responsibility for Auction to 9th Army, all like this handsome, boyish-looking 39-year-old architect. To the man, they considered Hutchhausen a great addition to their small army, with just one caveat. Everyone had a difficult time pronouncing Hutchhausen correctly, so they immediately gave him the name Hutch. Even in the early weeks of his first assignment in Auction, Hutch demonstrated the kind of initiative that earned the respect of his more experienced peers by converting the Sermont Museum into a safe house for works of art being found in dozens of locations in and around the city. Hancock couldn't figure out if Hutch's popularity with soldiers or some magical touch was responsible for his ability to procure transportation, but it was certainly a skill that he admired. Near Nancy, France, December 1944. In December, after 6 months of waiting in London, Lincoln Kirstein, another new recruit to the Monuments Men, finally arrived in Europe, none too happy about all the delays. Most of the Monuments Men knew Kirstein, a towering figure in the arts. He'd authored 6 books, co-founded the American Ballet Company, Harvard Society for Contemporary Art, and Hound and Horn Literary Magazine, and been a successful art critic all before his 37th birthday. Simply put, Kirstein was a polymath, exceptionally gifted in multiple fields. George Stout had instructed Kirstein when he was a graduate student at Harvard. Jim Rorimer, the hard-charging curator, had befriended him when they both lived and worked in New York City. In Germany, Kirstein was just another soldier in uniform, at least to Robert Posey. Like any new soldier, he would have to prove himself. As Posey looked over the new man's resume and thought about what he'd heard others say about Kirstein, he realized just how different they both were, an odd couple pairing extraordinaire. Posey loved being a soldier and understood life in the military. Kirstein found the experience dreadful. Posey knew the rules and followed them. Kirstein preferred to write his own. Posey approached problems logically. Kirstein trusted his instinct and liked to improvise. Posey tended to be stable in demeanor. Kirstein was manic depressive. The Posey family had been so poor that Robert's mother gave his sister to an aunt after his father died because there wasn't enough food for 3 children. Kirstein, the son of a wealthy self-made businessman, never experienced poverty. Posey knew a lot about architecture, but not a great deal about works of art. And it was at that moment that he realized why someone, probably Stout, had paired the two of them. Kirstein knew a lot about everything, including art and architecture. No wonder Stout, Rorimer, and other monuments officers had pleaded with the Roberts Commission and the Army to get Kirstein into the MFAA. One other distinction couldn't be missed. Every monuments man in Northern Europe served as an officer but one. Lincoln Kirstein, who held one of the lowest ranks in the Army, private first class. Some arcane Army rule prohibited privates from serving in the MFAA. Only repeated pleadings by the Roberts Commission resulted in the Army relenting and making this exception. Kirstein wouldn't officially begin his position until January. Until then, Posey had plenty of reports to write, including an update on the Ghent altarpiece. That's a laugh, he thought. With no leads of any sort, that particular report will be a blank page. Posey also had letters to write, especially with Christmas fast approaching. A rather large package from home marked "With love from your family" had arrived a few weeks earlier. He'd wanted to save it for Christmas Day, but on December 16th, the mixture of excitement, curiosity, and loneliness prevailed. Alice had really packed the box well, far better than all the others, he noticed, which forced him to slow down and savor the moment. There seemed no end to the material she used. Finally, he reached something firm, a package within a package that he pulled out of the box. Snugly taped between 2 protective layers of cardboard, he found a phonograph record. The absence of a note made him even more curious. With his helmet in one hand and the record in the other, he dashed out of his tent to special services, where a sergeant manning the radios motioned Posey into an adjacent room while he put the disc on the record player. After an agonizingly slow few moments, he heard something, not music, but a voice, one absent from his life for more than a year, emerge from the nearby speaker. Alice spoke first, prompting Woogie to say something you want. As Posey thought about it, speaking into a microphone to your dad when you can't see him must have been a weird experience for a seven-year-old boy. Then came his son's voice and Christmas greetings and more comments from them both, followed by a song. During war, surprises were rarely welcomed. Posey considered this an extraordinary exception, a single moment that would sustain him as long as necessary and serve as a lifelong reminder of the importance of family. That evening, still basking in the glow of the Christmas greeting from his family, Posey heard a radio report about a new German offensive in the Ardennes forest. U.S. troops had tried to absorb the blow but were falling back. First reports were often suspect, so Posey decided to hang around special services to find out more. Stop there on page 129, and we'll begin chapter 10, Longings, Paris, France at Christmas time, 1944, next time. Thank you so much, eighth graders. Take care of yourselves. Bye-bye.